Stanford University.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Beth Fanskak, the Leah Kaplan Visiting Professor of Human Rights at the Law School, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you all this evening and to moderate this evening's event. First, I want to give some thanks to First Stanford Global Studies, which is the parent organization for the Handa Center for International Human Rights, for Human Rights and International Justice, which is the sponsor of this evening's event. Thank you for the Humanities Center for giving us this lovely venue to meet in. To John Ruff, who is the benefactor who endowed this lecture series. Unfortunately, he could not be here this evening, but he sends his regards to everyone here. And of course, to the State Department, who made this lecture possible. The way this evening will go is I will introduce our speaker, then we'll hear from Assistant Secretary Malinowski, then we'll shift to the fireside chat. I'll lead off with a couple of questions, and then we'll open it up to the audience for Q&A, and we can go until about 7 this evening. So first, to introduce our speaker. So I'm very pleased to introduce Assistant Secretary Tom Malinowski to give the first of two Handa lectures this year. He has devoted his career to advancing and promoting international human rights from a number of different perches, both within government and within civil society. And in that latter capacity, he's often found himself being very critical of not only the US government, but of other governments and their human rights records. And in many respects, I think it's a testament to this administration to have the courage to bring someone like Assistant Secretary Malinowski into the fold, in a way, to represent this country on the international scene in the human rights field. At the moment, he's obviously serving as Assistant Secretary of State for Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor within the U.S. State Department, a position he has held since April 2014. Although the goal of promoting human rights infuses much of U.S. foreign policy, DRL, which is the acronym, of course, every organization in the State Department has its own acronym, and his happens to be DRLs. DRLs really has the lead on human rights policy in the United States government. It works to hold governments and others accountable for their obligations under the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and other multilateral human rights treaties. Through its programming and its diplomacy, it works to advance human rights around the world. And regardless of how those human rights might be characterized, civil and political rights, economic, social, and cultural rights, it also works on behalf of all persons, regardless of race, ethnicity, religion, gender, sexual orientation, disability, et cetera. All individuals should enjoy these rights, and that's a fundamental tenet of DRL's work. A signature accomplishment of DRL is the issuance every year of a country report of human rights. It surveys all 196, or whatever we're up to at this point, human rights countries around the globe. And that report is read avidly by academics, advocates, and others for the state of human rights in the world and also for human rights trends around the globe. And importantly, some of the work of DRL that is not maybe as well known and is not as visible is working on behalf of defenders of human rights who are working around the globe, often at great personal risk. Prior to his appointment to DRL, Assistant Secretary Malinowski was the Washington Director of Human Rights Watch, which needs little introduction. It's one of the premier independent human rights organizations around the world. Prior to that point, he was Senior Director in the National Security Council, working in the White House, where he oversaw the drafting of many of President Clinton's foreign policy speeches and also strategic communications around the globe. Prior to that, he was a speechwriter for Secretaries of State Warren Christopher and Madeleine Albright, and also a member of the policy planning staff of the U.S. State Department. He received his MPhil from Oxford University, where he was a Rhodes Scholar. And although he received his BA from the University of California at Berkeley, he has graciously accepted and promised to wear with great pride on a regular basis a bright red Stanford hoodie. So please join me in welcoming Assistant Secretary Tom Malinowski to the podium.
Some of that wasn't true. And not just the absence of a fire. The fire said, where's the fire? Hello, class. Thank you. Thank you, Beth, for that introduction. And I also want to thank the Handa Center for Human Rights and International Justice for inviting me to speak here on this fine evening. Now, when I got this invitation, for reasons you can now imagine, I do admit to have hesitated for a moment. But then I remembered my duties. After all, it's my job as Assistant Secretary of State in charge of promoting human rights around the world to venture to the darkest places and there and there to defend what is right and true, to come face to face with dictators and demons and to try to lead them to the light. And if I can do all of that on an almost daily basis, then I guess I can come to Stanford. Now, I do have a lot of friends here. I see Larry Diamond here in the audience, and also a bunch of refugees from the Obama administration, Mike McFaul, who gifted me with said item, Jeremy Weinstein, with whom I worked very, very closely in the last several years in the Obama administration. And I have to say, I envy them. Not just because they get to live so tantalizingly close to the cultural, intellectual, architectural, culinary mecca of the East Bay, but because they now have more time to think. It's not an easy thing to do in the daily rush of life in government, to the detriment, I fear, of our daily work in government. But since you've given me this chance, I will use it to reflect on what I've learned in now almost 2 years in this job, and to offer some thoughts on the anxious and confusing times in which we find ourselves. I will reflect on what's going on in the world, what's going right, what's going wrong. I'll try to explain why, if we have realism, patience, perspective, we should be confident in America's power to make things better over time. And along the way, I will quote three of my favorite philosophers. The first one happens to be our president. Last year in Brussels, President Obama gave a speech that I think captures a lot of what's going on in the world today, a lot of what's troubling us in the world today. He said that, quote, throughout human history, societies have grappled with fundamental questions of the proper relationship between the individual and the state. Over time, he added, a particular set of ideals began to emerge, the belief that through conscience and free will, each of us has the right to live as we choose, the belief that power is derived from the consent of the governed, and that laws and institutions should be established to protect that understanding. But those ideals have often been threatened by an older, more traditional view of power, that ordinary men and women are too small-minded to govern their own affairs, that order and progress can only come when individuals surrender their rights to an all-powerful sovereign, or that by virtue of race or faith or ethnicity, some are inherently superior to others, or that national greatness must flow not by what people stand for, but what they are against. Now, if you look around the world, you'll see this age-old argument about power playing out in more places than ever before. And despite all the difficulties, I happen to still be convinced that the good guys have the upper hand in that fight, the good guys who believe in human rights and in government bound by law. I was just a couple of weeks ago in Burma, where, as you all know, not long ago, a military junta ruled the country by fear. And now, actually just in the last couple of days, after 25 years of peaceful democratic struggle, elected civilians took over control of the government of their country. When the people of Burma voted last November, their military still was strong enough to intimidate them. Some people were still in prison for expressing their opinions, but the voters turned out to be not afraid. And we saw, again, how in that moment when citizens, ordinary people, are alone in a voting booth, when there's no gun to their head and a real choice in their hands, they have all the power in the world. Now, the same kind of people power won out in the country of Sri Lanka last year, when the two communities that have been divided in that country, the Sinhalese and the the Tamils came together to vote out an authoritarian government. It is rising in Venezuela today, where voters recently showed their overwhelming desire for change in legislative elections, despite a ruling party's overwhelming control of police and courts and media. It is persevering, although with difficulties in Tunisia, where despite attack after attack by ISIL, the one true democracy to emerge from the Arab Spring is showing the strength of the one idea with a chance to defeat the nihilistic ideology of the terrorists. It has a chance in Nigeria, where millions of people defied threats from Boko Haram recently to go to the polls and choose leaders committed to rooting out corruption and restoring security in their country. In fact, all over Africa, young people are challenging entrenched rulers who have been in power for years and years and decades and decades. I don't think President Obama has gotten louder applause from any audience than when he said recently in a speech to the African Union in Addis Ababa that no one should be president for life. So everywhere, actually, that I travel to, that I look at, ordinary citizens are driving this kind of progress. They're creating civil society groups that monitor elections, that empower women and people with disabilities, that expose corruption, counter violent extremism, build bridges across religious and ethnic divides, and perform 1,000 other useful tasks. And they do this while communicating across borders and past all of the barriers that dictatorships place in their path. And when they are persecuted today, in virtually every case, the world knows about it and can say something about it. And that's a revolutionary change in my lifetime, and I don't think it can be turned back. But even as this idea of democracy takes root in more and more places, actually, I'd say because it has taken root in so many places, that older view of power that President Obama talked about is fighting its way back. The most extreme manifestation, of course, is ISIL, which I think at bottom is a vehicle for people who want order and power, the power to kill and to rape and to own other human beings, and who are looking for a veneer of religious legitimacy to justify that very old fantasy. We also see that fundamentally authoritarian impulse expressed in more familiar ways in the brutal reaction to the Arab Spring uprisings in Assad, Syria, and elsewhere in the Middle East, in China, where a government that can no longer justify one-party rule on ideological grounds or on the grounds of endless economic growth is resorting to lashing out at dissidents at home and now even kidnapping them abroad, something that we are very, very deeply concerned about right now in the Obama administration. In Russia, where even those human rights organizations that survived Soviet communism are now being vilified as traitors, and where the government is using homophobia to divide its society just as its predecessors used anti-Semitism. We see it also in the politics of fear that is descending on a lot of democratic countries. Fear of refugees, fear of minorities, fear of the world beyond our borders, anxieties from a time that we thought was long buried. Now, I think history works in cycles. If you think about it, after World War I, President Wilson inspired millions of people with this vision of a world that would be united and at peace. We got the League of Nations out of that, but then what happens? A Red Scare in the United States, economic depression, isolation, demagogues like Father Coughlin preaching to millions of Americans on radio, hatred of Jews. Then we recover from that. We go to war against fascism, save and unite the world, build a global organization dedicated to peace and a great alliance of democracy, and then what happens? McCarthyism at home, division of Europe, a 40-year Cold War when one false move could have ended it all. Now, we know this. We know it from our experience. And yet there are times when we feel that we're at last on the verge of breaking out of that cycle. Some of us may have allowed ourselves a brief moment of such hope when President Obama was elected in 2008, when we watched him give that Cairo speech, when we saw the reaction around the world to the ascendance of this extraordinarily intelligent and talented and inspiring and unifying American president. Now, I think America has achieved really amazing and great things in the world in the last few years, but against headwinds that we did not always imagine or foresee. I did not think then that we'd be dealing now with a regime in Syria demolishing entire cities, using poison gas against its people, or that as a result, hundreds of thousands of human beings would be walking, literally walking across Europe, driving support for xenophobic political parties that threaten the liberal idea of European Union. A little crisis that begins in Syria, and that's what it leads to. Few of us at that time expected to face two great powers promoting authoritarian values as aggressively as Russia and China are in their much copied campaigns against NGOs and an open internet. Few of us imagined that out of the turmoil of the Middle East, we'd get a terrorist group even more destructive than Al-Qaeda. And now, after all that, we even have to endure Vladimir Putin telling us that it's all our fault, that it was America's promotion of liberal values, our embrace of democratic reformers and good governance, from Eastern Europe to the Middle East, all over the world, that caused all that turmoil. Here's what Putin said last year to the UN General Assembly. Instead of the triumph of democracy and progress, we got violence, poverty, social disaster, and nobody cares a bit about human rights, including the right to life. I cannot help asking those who have forced that situation, do you realize what you have done? And he was pointing at us. Now, in a sense, Putin is saying what some self-styled realists in the United States say, that by trying to remake the world in our democratic image, America's actually making everything worse. Here's the problem, I think, with that argument. It wasn't the United States that gave all those people from the Middle East to Ukraine, to Burma, to Burundi, the idea that their governments should serve them instead of stealing from them. Yes, it's true that ideals that we professed have inspired those people in many cases. Legal norms that we have helped to forge over many years have empowered many of those people. But it was they who decided to remake their worlds in their image of what a just society demands. Now, in thinking about this, let's take a look in particular at what's happened in Libya in the last few years, since that is the example that Putin and a lot of critics probably think most strongly supports the accusation that I just mentioned to you. In February of 2011, when the Libyan revolution started, I am quite certain that nobody in the US government had any idea what was about to happen there. And here's what happened. Basically, a few dozen lawyers and activists in the city of Benghazi in Libya marched on their courthouse to demand the release of a few political prisoners who'd just been arrested. And within days, that protest spiraled in ways that nobody could have imagined, until the Gaddafi regime basically pulled out of the eastern part of its country. And these few dozen activists suddenly found themselves in control of a huge piece of territory. And that happened not because anybody outside of Libya encouraged it, but because Libyans wanted it desperately. Now, it was only when Gaddafi sent tanks and artillery against those people, when he regrouped and decided, I'm going to retake what I have lost, that the United States and our allies, authorized by the UN Security Council, took military action to protect them. Now, what if we had not done that? What if we had allowed Gaddafi to crush Benghazi in early 2011? I would say it's pretty preposterous to suggest that Libya would now be a peaceful and happy place. Here's what I think would have happened, and I spent a lot of time in Libya in 2011 as this was unfolding. Libya's rebels would not have given up. The fight would have continued from the city of Benghazi to other cities, to Misrata and Zintan and Tobruk. Just like in Syria, we probably would have seen years of back and forth slaughter. In this situation, the extremists that we're most concerned about would have not only found safe haven, but genuine support from a desperate population that would have felt abandoned by the outside world, rather than the revulsion that groups like ISIL now inspire in the vast majority of the Libyan people. Here, I think, is the truth of the matter. People want to be free. They want to be treated with dignity and respect. They want to be in control of their lives. And when these things are denied to them, sometimes they will endure for a while, but eventually they will stand up and fight to get what they want. But by the same token, power never gives way easily. Dictators, when they're confronted by people marching on their palace, they never say, all right, I guess you guys are right. Let's have a free election, and if I lose fair and square, I'll congratulate you and go home. That never happens. They dig in and they fight dirty and hard, and if they lose one battle, they don't give up. Because for them, the struggle is existential. In their world, if you lose power, you lose everything. You may even lose your life. So it would have been naive, I think, for us to expect that the citizens of the Middle East back in 2011 would have, or before then, would have forever endured governments that denied them basic freedom. Something like the Arab Spring was bound to happen. But it would have been equally naive to think that the old order there would give way without a long and at times violent fight. Or for that matter, that Putin would react mildly when Russians and Ukrainians started asking for a clean government and free elections, or that the Chinese government would react kindly to those arguing that their party should bend to the law rather than the law bending to the party. So this contest of ideals, I think, is inevitable, and it often leads to friction. The only thing that's ever in doubt is the outcome. And that's where we come in, because while we don't set the contest in motion, we have a huge stake in its outcome. Think of the biggest threats to global order and security today and where they come from. In Syria, a dictator tries to crush a democratic uprising, and out of the chaos, we get ISIL and the worst refugee crisis of our time. In Russia, an increasingly authoritarian government is threatened by democracy movement at home. It sees another one rise next door. And what happens? It launches the first land grab in Europe since World War II. So it makes sense that we should defend people around the world who are trying peacefully to advance respect for human rights before conflict between power and people leads to the kinds of crises that we want to avoid. Our mistake has not been that we've tried to defend those people and advance those values. It's been sometimes to think that helping the good guys won't take a lot of time or effort, or that they can win without resistance, without friction, without crisis. The hopeful democratic success stories, or nascent success stories, that I mentioned earlier, for example, Burma and Sri Lanka, they only came about after years after year after year of struggle within those countries and diplomatic efforts by the United States. It took us almost 25 years to get to this moment in Burma. The Obama administration stuck it out for 6 or 7 years with Sri Lanka after the end of their civil war in 2009. And here's the interesting thing. In all those years, when we were working on those issues in those countries, there was not one moment when there was even a scintilla of evidence that what we were doing was working. Only after the change happened, when we looked back, we realized actually we had contributed to the change that happened. Because authoritarian governments, they're never going to say to you, you know what, that policy you've put in place, it's beginning to have an effect on us. You know, we're really thinking about this. They don't. And even when you get to that point of democratic transition that we've gotten to in a number of hopeful places around the world, the full transition to stable democracy, true respect for the rule of law, political scientists tell us that takes, in the successful cases, on average around 20 years. By that measure, a country like Tunisia, 5 years after the Arab Spring, is actually ahead of the curve. Even Libya, though it was hijacked by militias and assaulted by violent extremists, has a chance. It's held successful elections. It has a courageous civil society. And now, thanks in part to really painstaking efforts by my boss, Secretary Kerry, and by our special envoy for Libya, Jonathan Weiner, its political factions have agreed to a unity government. As I said, I was lucky enough to have spent time in Libya in 2011, and I hoped then that the incredible idealism of the people I met might have been foundation enough for a successful democracy. That was unrealistic in a country with millions of guns and virtually no working institutions. But if a country like Libya can actually start to come together just 5 years after that kind of trauma, that would be a far better result than had its revolution failed, and far better than the calamity that has befallen Syria. Such a result was, and I think remains, worth working for. We just have to accept that this kind of work requires discipline and patience and realism. You have to set a strategy. You have to stick with it over time. You have to have some confidence in your ability to achieve success over time. Sometimes you have to put in place a policy that will probably not come to fruition until your successors are in office or your successors' successors. And sometimes you've got to accept that the ideal that we're striving for in the world is never going to be fully realized, that the contest with all the ups and downs is always going to continue. We stopped mass killing in Bosnia when I was a young person working for Bill Clinton in 1995. 20 years later, the country is still struggling to achieve stability. We saw democracy rise in Eastern Europe after the Iron Curtain fell, and now people in Hungary are electing leaders that are questioning its fundamentals. We had a free election in Burma, as I mentioned, but now some people there are using their freedom to demonize Muslims. When we act, we can never know what the second and third order effect of our actions is going to be. Sometimes we make the world better. Sometimes, as the philosopher Isaiah Berlin wrote, all we can do is preserve an uneasy equilibrium, which is constantly threatened and constantly in need of repair. Either way, as he added, we can only do what we can, but that we must do against difficulties. So here's what we try to do in the Obama administration. We defend activists and NGOs wherever they face pushback, as our president has asked us to do through his Stand with Civil Society initiative. We speak out when governments stifle dissent, including in countries with which we cooperate closely, like Saudi Arabia when it flogs a blogger, or Ethiopia when it imprisons journalists. We stand up for a single open internet that unites people across the world, rather than the vision of a Russian internet and a Chinese internet and an Indian internet. We know that corruption props up predatory and failed states, so we make the fight against it a first order priority. We insist that foreign security forces, the ones that we train to fight terrorism, respect human rights, because we know that's the only way they can build the social trust they need to win. We stand by our old alliances with countries that share our values, and we forge new agreements like the Trans-Pacific Partnership that President Obama just signed today, with inducements to respect human rights. We champion the inclusion of countries like Russia and China in a rules-based international system, but we defend those rules if those countries break them at home or abroad. We muster every element of our power to try to prevent mass atrocities, and where possible, we act with our allies to to stop them, as we did in Libya, as we did in the defense of the Yazidis in Iraq when ISIL tried to eliminate them from the face of the earth. Facing the most terrible crisis in the world in Syria, we continue to try, as Secretary Kerry does every day, to find a solution that will save lives while channeling help to people inside who are keeping their communities alive and fighting for the justice that must eventually come there. Now, foreign policy experts, some you may know, keep writing op-eds wondering if the United States can still play a leading role in addressing these kinds of challenges. The non-experts who actually live in the countries facing these challenges don't appear to have read most of those articles. It's the United States to which they keep on turning. The Christians in Iraq who expect us to save their ancient communities, the young people in Burundi and Congo who ask us to speak out when their presidents try to change their constitutions, the factory workers in Vietnam who seek our help in starting independent trade unions, the anti-corruption campaigners in Russia who ask us to keep illicit funds out of our banks. None of these people expects us to fight their battles for them or suggests that America alone can solve their problems. But they believe, reasonably, that there's always something we can do. They've seen us do it. A couple of years ago, just before I started this job, I went to Syria, to a part of Syria that was already under the control of the rebel groups that have been fighting Assad. And I met a lot of people there who asked me why the United States could not do more to stop Assad from bombing their homes. And I tried to be honest with them. I tried to explain our experience in Iraq and how many people in the United States were wary of getting more deeply involved in more countries in the Middle East, and how limited our power sometimes seems from the vantage point of Washington. I really tried to channel all of the anxieties that we feel as a people about these kinds of involvements. And these people, who, mind you, were very conservative Sunnis with really jaded views of the United States of America, looked at me like I was stark raving mad. "Of course you can do something if you choose," they said. "And if not you, who else are we going to turn to? Russia? China?" In fact, we can't do everything for everybody all of the time. There are problems we can't solve. But we are still, by far, the most powerful, the most productive, the most creative country in the world. Unlike some other great powers, we are not slaves to the price of oil. Our government doesn't have to fear its own people. No one else has anything close to our global reach or our globalist attitude. Our hopes for the world may not and probably never will be fully realized. History is usually two steps forward and one and three-quarter steps back. But the world beyond our borders is not falling apart. It is presenting a challenge to which we must rise. And if we keep doing so, I think things will get better, slowly but surely. And meanwhile, we'll be able to say, in the words of the last great philosopher I'll quote today, the immortal Billy Joel, "We didn't start the fire. No, we didn't light it, but we tried to fight it." Thank you very much. I look forward to your questions.
As you mentioned, the United States has often served as a beacon for human rights in the world. But of course, at the same time, there's been criticism of many of our policies. Guantanamo, detention center, custodial detention abuses, police brutality, race relations, our drone program, our weapons exports, our detention of the death penalty, you know, the list goes on. When you're out there in the world trying to promote international human rights, how do you address this mixed record when you're confronted with it, particularly by an interlocutor whom you're trying to influence in the direction of greater respect for human rights?
Well, first of all, we've had those critics arrested, so I don't think we'll have that problem for too much longer. number one, we can't... So, number one, we can't effectively advance these values around the world. We know that if we're not living them at home. We have to set a reasonably good example. I say reasonably good because perfection escapes us all as countries, as individuals. I spent a lot of time in my last part of my career trying to fight a previous administration over the fact that we were torturing people as a matter of national policy, and not to mention Guantanamo and a lot of other problems that were being thrown in our face all over the world. Although some of my most interesting memories of that time from Human Rights Watch were of activists coming to see me to say, number one, how can you get the Bush administration to stop the torture? And number two, who can I speak to in the Bush administration to get their help with the torture in my country? And so even then, you know, like no one excused us from our obligations to be promoting human rights around the world, even when we were setting a pretty miserable example in some respects. Because again, who else are you going to turn to? And so there was the sadness that we weren't living up to the ideal, but again, it didn't excuse us. So now what do I say? Yeah, this still comes up. Different issues come up. As you can imagine, people say, how can you lecture us? You've got police officers abusing people's rights in the United States and you know, and all the other things that you might imagine. And what I say is, number one, we are far from perfect. We have injustices in the United States. We have a lot of problems that we haven't fixed that we have to fix. We welcome criticism from our friends around the world when we need to do better. So number one, have at it. I'm not defensive about it. It's totally legitimate for other countries to talk to us about those problems. So that begins to disarm it a little bit. Number two, I say that what distinguishes us and what we ask of others is simply that we have systems and institutions and laws and practices and traditions that allow the citizens of our country, when they face an injustice, a problem that needs to be resolved, to demand change. And we don't punish those people. We empower those people. And there is recourse. And eventually change happens. And then we move on to the next problem and the next injustice. And again, that's all we ask of other countries. When we had the very significant problems in Ferguson, Missouri, we did not arrest the lawyers of Michael Brown. We did not take journalists off the streets and prosecute them for treason because they were exposing the reality of what was happening there. Our president, when there were journalists who were roughed up in the initial days, went on national television and said, we do not tolerate that in the United States of America. That's all we ask. If we had that in Russia and in China and in Vietnam and in Cuba and in all the other places where we talk about these issues, we wouldn't have to talk about these issues. And I find that combined with an honest, non-defensive acknowledgement of continuing injustices in the United States tends to win over everybody who at least is sincere in raising these concerns rather than simply using them as a means of deflection.
Before you joined government, President Obama created the Atrocities Prevention Board, which is an interagency body geared towards creating a whole of governance approach.
If your mic is off.
Better now? Okay, great. Prior to your entering government, President Obama created the Interagency Atrocities Prevention Board, the idea being to create a board that would devote a whole-of-government approach to preventing atrocities around the world with an eye towards trying to intervene earlier in more upstream in situations before they become full-scale conflagrations and human rights disasters. To some, this has been hailed as the most important human rights development in U.S. foreign policy since the creation of your own bureau, DRL. And to others, they have derided it as more of a sort of bureaucratic rearranging of the deck chairs. I'm wondering where you come out on the APB, given that it's had a couple of years of experience now, and you've seen it up and running. Did you have some successes you can point to? Are there failures of this entity? Are there ways that we should be strengthening it? And what's its longevity in a new administration?
Well, the truth lies somewhere in between. That often happens, right? It's not the solution to the problem of mass atrocities in the world. There's no bureaucratic solution to that. It's a question of political will and resources and capacity. But it's a good thing. It's helped us. So here's the basic idea is, number one, we don't always want to wait until the massacres begin to start thinking about what are we going to do? What can we do? Because by then it's usually too late to do anything other than the most difficult thing, which is military intervention. But two, when problems like that are brewing in a country, they often don't rise to the level they need to rise to in the U.S. government, particularly if it's in a country that we don't think about a lot, that may be not one of the top 10 areas of national interest in the world. Your Burundis and Ivory Coasts and the Rohingya crisis in Burma and so on and so forth. And so the basic function of the Atrocities Prevention Board is to be watchful for situations that might evolve into a massive humanitarian crisis, a genocide, mass atrocities, and to raise the level of attention within the US government. Because the rule is, if the Atrocities Prevention Board sends up a memo to the president, it's got to go through, and he's going to look at it. It's not going to be blocked at various bureaucratic layers. So it forces everybody to think about something before it reaches that point of crisis. Now, what happens from that point on is not really affected by whether we have an APB or not. What happens from that point on is that senior policymakers look at exactly the same considerations that they would have looked at before. How bad is this? What do we feel we can do? What are the potential costs of various courses of action? Can we afford those costs? And so on and so forth. And the decision-making process is then exactly the same. The difference is it forces them to go through that process. And I think that's a good thing, but it's not necessarily revolutionary. Where it's had an impact, it's not really relevant in the high-profile crises like Syria, because we don't need an Atrocities Prevention Board to tell us that this is the worst thing in the world. It's been, I think, very useful in lower-profile situations like Burundi, in making sure that it becomes a high-profile issue for the administration, as it has. Central African Republic is another example, not a country that most past presidents would have spent a lot of time thinking about, to be honest. But when the APB says, this is important, President Obama will, and actions result from that.
Great, thank you. So you mentioned the Islamic State in your remarks, and of course it's one of the central foreign policy dilemmas of the era. And you also mentioned the whole range of tools that DRL and other elements of the U.S. government have developed in order to deal with human rights situations, sanctions, multilateral coalitions, accountability tools. How do you even think about using those tools with respect to the Islamic State when it's bent on creating a regime that's characterized by brutal discrimination, by slavery, as you mentioned, and by sheer violence?
A lot of the tools you just mentioned we developed to influence states. Mm-hmm. And whatever they may call themselves, I don't like to think of them as a state, and also I don't think they're particularly amenable to those forms of persuasion. You know, economic sanctions, actually we are using economic tools to try to restrict their ability to sell oil and to buy the things that they need to sustain themselves. The justice tools, absolutely, we will strongly support the prosecution of members of ISIL that may be captured and who are guilty of mass atrocities. But I don't think that prospect is going mm-hmm. to deter them mm-hmm. one bit. It's the right thing to do. It's not necessarily a tool for stopping this. So there are other things we have to do. There's a military component, which we have to pursue. And that means killing people on the battlefield. There is a strong messaging component to this, which you know you all have read about both the importance and the difficulties of engaging in effective counter messaging. And then there's the very, very important, and this now comes even more close to what DRL is involved with, component of establishing effective governance in the places where ISIL takes advantage of its absence, or is in fact the product of its absence, as I think is the case in Iraq and in Syria and in Libya and in many other places. And so making sure that as territory is liberated from ISIL in Iraq, that there are effective Iraqi institutions, not just military, but police and justice and social service providers that are able to come in immediately and that serve all people equally rather than favoring one group over another. That's an incredibly difficult challenge, but it's absolutely essential to this task. And then finally, and this is a core part of what my bureau does, and related to everything I was talking about in the speech, the core promotion of human rights and democracy is central to this effort. It's not a trade-off, as sometimes people like to argue. Well, we either, you know, work with countries to fight these terrorists, or we kind of push them on democracy and human rights. Because it is precisely the absence of any opportunity for people with grievances to work peacefully within their societies through a democratic process to seek change that drives some, a small minority, to say violence is the only way. We've seen that cycle repeat itself again and again in the Middle East. We've seen it in Egypt in the past. Al-Qaeda emerged in part from political crackdowns in Egypt in the 1990s and the torture that went on in Egyptian prisons when thousands and thousands of young men were packed together in horrific conditions in prison. And out of that cadre came a small group that became Al-Qaeda. And so when we see something similar happening in Egypt today, in the name of fighting terrorism, we say to them, as Secretary Kerry has, actually, you are making this fight harder for us, not easier. And so the promotion of just good old-fashioned promotion of human rights and democracy, particularly in countries that are facing this risk, absolutely central to the fight.
Thank you. Questions from the audience? I think, are there microphones? Yes, microphones floating around. So you want to, Julian, you can just, the glasses.
Hello, dear Assistant Secretary. You mentioned the refugee crisis as one of the biggest problems that the world faces. And as it is expected in 2016, it will get worse. It is true that the U.S. has been the country that has devoted most financial resources to solving the problem, but it certainly has not played a leadership role when it is about in terms of taking in refugees and helping the countries in Europe that can, that are unable or unwilling to take in. What are the main obstacles for U.S. to be leaders in solving this problem?
Fear. You know what the obstacle is. First of all, you're absolutely right that we, although we have been quite generous over the years, both in our financial contributions and in taking a lot of people from a lot of difficult places in the world, and bringing them to these shores and integrating them into our country, we can do more and we should do more. And President Obama has said that, and Secretary Kerry has said that. We've asked our Congress to help us be more generous. But as you know, there's a lot of fear out there in the land, and it's stoked by, just as we see in Europe, just as we see in many parts of the world, it's stoked by politicians who see that as a potent narrative that they can use. And then there are also, there are legitimate security issues which have led us over the years to set a very, very, very high standard for number one, who can come to this country, and well, and number two, resulting in very long time periods, even when somebody goes through the process and is approved. So we can do more, we should do more. We face both some practical obstacles and a very big political obstacle that we will continue to strive to overcome, and we encourage everyone who believes in this cause to speak out about, because we need absolutely every voice. The last thing I'll say is that even if we were 10 times more generous, it would not be much more than a drop in the bucket, given the scale of the refugee crisis. And so when we look at what's happening in Syria, I want us to be as generous as possible, but I don't want us to see the problem primarily through the frame of how we can help the refugees. I want to see it through the frame of how we can stop the outflow of refugees and create conditions where people who have left feel they have a home to go back to and to rebuild.
Up here, Fred.
Hi, you mentioned China briefly. Like, mainland China has been going through a lot of, especially with the Hong Kong protests, the disappearance of the four, I think it was like four journalists that wrote like articles on Xi Jinping, these kinds of things. How do you guys address them, even though when China wields so much financial power in the world now? I mean, its influence has increased. Like, we've seen an influx of, it's just the growth, China's reach has grown over the last 10 years. How can we influence powers like that when they have so much reach all over the world?
I think the one of the secrets is recognizing that what appears to be the projection of confidence and strength from China is actually a manifestation of deep insecurity and weakness. Yes, of course, it's a very big country with a larger and larger share of the global economy. But the Chinese government, I think, is going through an increasingly insecure period. And I touched on this in the speech, that this is it's a one-party state that doesn't derive legitimacy through the consent of the governed in a formalistic sense, but is still very concerned about its legitimacy. Most dictatorships actually, this is very interesting, are much more insecure about their legitimacy than democracies. Barack Obama doesn't have to worry about his legitimacy. He got elected, no one questions it. Well, some people do, but but reasonable people don't. But if you don't have that, if you can't point to sort of a formal process that justifies the power that you wield, including to arrest people, to kill people under extreme circumstances, you can be very insecure, and you sort of try to gain legitimacy through from some other source. And in China, for many years, there was ideological legitimacy, communism, the belief in the party and its historical role and the good that it was doing, and that's gone, of course. Nobody believes in communism in China. So then it was unlimited, extraordinary economic growth. And we've seen in the last couple of years that that's going away because the growth is declining. There's economic trials and tribulations that have led a lot of people in China around the world to question whether this government can competently manage the economy. And so what's left? Not much, except for trying to find enemies and rallying people against those enemies. And some of those enemies, perceived enemies, are domestic critics of the government, but also external. And so in that sense, kind of the lashing out in the South China Sea and the lashing out internally are part of the same problem. But I think if we see it, going back to your question, more as a manifestation of insecurity, I think we can have more confidence in the long term in our ability to help people in China. It has to be them doing it. We can't do it for them. But to help draw the lines that enable them over time to overcome this. And to know that when we stand up for things like an open internet, where young people in China and all around the world can communicate with each other and have access to information and not be told, no, you're not worthy of knowing this fact. We don't trust you. That we're aligning ourselves with the vast majority of people in China who agree with that. When we say that environmental information should be open and published, and or that people who get sick because a factory is leaking pollutants into the water and soil ought to be able to complain about it without getting arrested, we're aligning ourselves with the vast majority of people in China. That's a strength for us in the long term. When we say that people shouldn't be paraded on television to confess to crimes that they didn't commit before they're even charged in court, I can tell you probably the majority of people who are in the Communist Party in China would agree with us on that. So I think we've got to be, as I said in the speech, we have to be confident, we have to be steady. We can't imagine we're going to make any fundamental, can't transform things in a matter of months or even 2 or 3 years. But if we hold the line in defense of values that we share with people around the world, and we project confidence about it, we're going to be okay. There are a lot of countries in the world that are strong with the weak and weak with the strong. And if we're strong, and we project that through our actions, our statements, we're going to be just fine. And things will change for the better.
Way in the back.
Hi, my name is Ibrahim. I'm a sophomore here at Stanford. Welcome to Stanford. As you said, it's a dark kingdom, but I think it's not too bad. I really appreciated your mentioning of the fear politics that we've been seeing, because I think that's exactly what we've been seeing, especially in the 30-plus governors who expressed opposition to accepting Syrian refugees and the absolute mess that is the presidential race right now. In light of this, I think it's very easy to feel disheartened that the individuals that should be representing our collectively held principles on freedom are participating in fear politics. Thus, my question is, what would you recommend us as American citizens, and perhaps more particularly as students, in reacting and acting to these sentiments?
Okay. Number one, I think we're going to end up just fine on this. I'm not saying be complacent or don't worry, because the only way you get to just fine is by people standing up and fighting and working really, really hard. I do think ultimately we have one big advantage as a country in facing this kind of politics. not the first time in our history we've done it, by the way, right? There have been far worse than this in the past, and I mentioned some of them in our speech. But our big advantage is that we have, as a country, a set of foundational values that are in our founding documents that are the source of our national identity, and that virtually all Americans, whether they are liberal Democrats or Tea Party conservatives, claim to adhere to. And so you can ultimately win a lot of arguments in America by pointing to those unifying values. When we were arguing with the Bush administration over torture, the most effective line we used, and I'm going to be egotistical and claim credit for writing the line and giving it to my very good friend, John McCain. I'm a Democrat and work very closely with Republicans who care about human rights like him, even though we argue and fight about a lot of other things. And the line was, the terrorists are evil SOBs, but this is not about who they are, it's about who we are. And I remember when McCain said that line on the floor of the US Senate, it just like, the waters parted, because like, oh yeah, there you go. And so I think a lot of these arguments, whether it's about immigration, whether it's about, you know, how, you know, the ridiculous, hateful stuff about Muslims not being allowed to come to our country, you can actually point to those foundational values. Martin Luther King in his I Have a Dream speech, if you read that speech, it was all about what the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution and the founders of America promised to this country. And it turned out to be, as a political narrative, profoundly effective. So I guess my advice is, use that narrative and use it in all the work that you do, because you are going to have to scream and shout, and you're going to have to organize, you're going to have to tell political candidates that this is what you want, show up at their rallies, show up at the rallies of the people you disagree with, and confront them with patriotic American arguments for doing the right thing. But I think we're going to be okay. I'm a little bit more worried about some of the democracies in Europe, which don't have the same foundational set of values, even though they have evolved into strong democracies over time. Countries where national identity is not based on a set of abstract principles, but rather on nationality and ethnicity, as it has been in France and in Germany and in most European countries for many years. So I'm a little bit more worried, actually, about what's happening in Europe. And I think we have to be very vigilant in looking at that as well, and in working with our European partners, encouraging them, speaking out when necessary, just as they spoke out when we speak out when we depart from the straight and narrow path as well. So I hope that's helpful.
Right here in front. No. Hey, here she comes. It's helpful for the recording.
Hi. I wanted to ask you about situations in which immediate stability, particularly in the state building realm, immediate stability and human rights are often at odds, particularly when it has to do with the status quo. So by way of example, though this is by no means the only circumstance where this is happening, a place like Somalia in the process of rebuilding right now, and their justice system, which I'll talk a little bit about rebuilding being really key mm-hmm. to bringing human rights, has been one that is really oppressive to human rights for a really long time. And the process of building a new justice system is long, one that is more in line with notions of rule of law and some of these ideals that we do try to set forth. So in that sort of in-between state where we see the choice between stability and human rights, how do you help?
I'm not sure if I see that as a choice between stability and human rights. I see that as a situation where building real respect for human rights and rule of law is not something we can expect to happen from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds. It's something where, at best, a country is going to go through multiple stages of development, two steps forward, one and three quarters back, as I suggested. And but where I think it's unarguable that the greater respect for human rights you have, and the more respect for due process and rule of law you have in the justice system, the better off the country is going to be. So you work for that, you make that your goal, you make that your ideal, but you don't get frustrated and give up and go home because after a year of investment and effort and prodding, you realize that there is a prison in which people are being terribly mistreated, or a judge who's taking a bribe, or courts that still take direction from clan leaders or politicians or whatever, you know, problems you may be thinking about. You have the patience and perspective to stick with it, to recognize that although it may be a vastly different culture and people have vastly different experiences from, you know, someone in Palo Alto, they probably would prefer not to be tortured if they have a choice. They probably would prefer, if they have to go to court, to have a judge who's not taking bribes, and for the case not to be decided by who has the most money. I tend to find those are universal things. And so you gotta stick with it and just recognize that it may take 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and in the end, we'll be better off and they'll be better off.
Oh my goodness, way in the back. I agree.
Hi. I wanted to ask you about those nascent success stories that you mentioned at the beginning of your remarks. So the U.S. is currently facing quite a bit of criticism from activists for being extremely enthusiastic about partial change in both Sri Lanka and Burma, where major human rights difficulties persist. And I'm curious how you negotiate the need to both reward progress with continuing to push for deeper change.
Sure. They are partial. There's no question about it. I mentioned in Burma, you know, you have all this wonderful free elections and people, you know, Aung San Suu Kyi leading the country. And in the midst of it all, you have unbelievably sad and terrible persecution of the Rohingya Muslims living in internment camps. And these two things are both true. And they're occupying the same space in the same time. And a lot of other problems. In Sri Lanka, it's been a year since the democratic transition began. A lot of things have gone right, but there's still very powerful forces fighting to restore the old order, and reconciliation between Tamils and Sinhalese has only just begun. They've promised to do a lot of things to hold accountable those responsible for the crimes that were committed during the conflict, but they haven't actually kept those promises yet. So you're absolutely right. We have to find the right balance. Now, in a world where so much is going wrong, please forgive me if I look at the election that just happened in Burma and the fact that 100 former political prisoners were sworn in this week as parliamentarians as a good thing. I can't imagine getting from point A to point B in Burma, where point A was absolute totalitarian dictatorship 4 or 5 years ago, and point B is a real, honest-to-goodness democracy. I can't imagine getting there without going through some very difficult stages. Because again, power resists. It doesn't give way easily. And you give people freedom, and sometimes they're going to use it for ridiculous and even hateful things. So you got to welcome the good, and you just have to keep on working and exerting your leverage and your influence to deal with the bad. Burma, we haven't lifted all our sanctions. We still have targeted sanctions against some bad guys there. We haven't normalized our relationship with the Burmese military because it still holds a lot of reins of power in the country. And in Sri Lanka, we've tried to be really welcoming and supporting to these new leaders who are trying to do the right thing, but we have publicly said in recent days, you have to keep your commitments, because all the progress we've made is ultimately contingent on that. So that's what we try to do. And sometimes we probably go a little too far in one direction, a little too far in the other direction, but that's the idea.
In the purple shirt.
So you talked about history being cyclic, and you mentioned the potential annihilation of two countries, if not the world, during the Cold War. So I'm curious to know what efforts the DRL is taking, or the U.S. government is taking, for the elimination or reduction of nuclear weapons. I know we saw the Iran deal, but how do we justify an Iran deal when we just approved a $3 trillion budget for the next few years to expand and do research on our own nuclear weapons? So are we truly preventing anything, or are we just stopping others and maintaining our own mutual assured destruction within our own enemies at the moment? So I'm just curious what approach you're taking and what approaches the country's taking.
Yeah. It's frankly not a DRL issue per se, although you could argue legitimately that it should be, because obviously nuclear war would probably carry with it a few human rights concerns. I think really hard about it. Look, I'm a big believer in Barack Obama's original pledge to move to a world without nuclear weapons. I think it's arguably, just from a strategic standpoint, it is a weapon that empowers our adversaries, not the United States. It's not our comparative military advantage. It doesn't come from nuclear weapons. It's a very hard thing to wean yourself from when it has been such a central feature of global security for such a long time. And as you know, there was a lot of political resistance to the president's efforts early on to move us more definitively and rapidly in that direction. But the goal of a nuclear-free world is one that is actually a core part of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, and the United States has long, in principle, supported that goal. That said, I find myself, and now moving away from nuclear weapons, but I find myself, maybe as I get a little older, moving more in the direction of the kind of strong pro-defense side of things. As much as I've always been a liberal dedicated to liberal causes, as I look at the world today, I kind of find myself agreeing more and more with the notion that there are certain weapon systems that we never use, that we should have, precisely because having them means we will never have to use them. Weapon systems that preserve such a qualitative advantage for the United States, vis-a-vis countries that I think would not hesitate to behave aggressively if they felt that they could get away with it, that in the end, those weapon systems sit there, cost a lot of money and don't do anything, and that's really good because we're not challenged. I still think we're living in a world in which that's necessary, because I do not yet see an alternative to that. That's a personal view, has nothing to do with human rights policy or the DRL Bureau, but sense of the world today.
Right here in blue, I think this has to be our last question, unfortunately.
Hi, thank you for your remarks today. I just have a quick question about your remarks on building democracy, and for countries that were trying to move towards this newer, more liberal idea of power. What do you say to members of civil society, to leaders, right, who are looking to build their countries and somehow, for some reason, find the Russia model or the China model more attractive because of, stability, or because it'll give their country a bigger place on the world stage, or because they don't trust other members of their communities. What do you say to them, and how do you feel like the process moves forward with these people and with countries that are trying to decide.
Yeah. I don't think too many civil society organizations these days find the Russia or China model all that attractive, because it would mean they'd go to prison, or that their civil society organizations would be, let me actually, this is more likely, would be subject to more sophisticated forms of repression. Not necessarily sending people to prison, but creating extreme bureaucratic requirements that in practice make it virtually impossible to operate. This is what Russia in particular has been exporting as an idea, as a model to other countries. It's not particularly good for civil society, and not just human rights civil society, but environment civil society and anti-corruption civil society and labor civil society and virtually any kind of civil society. There is still among societies, among people, sure, sometimes different models seem more attractive. You know, part of that is attitudes about the United States, which are complicated, to say the least, around the world. Looking to other sources of power to challenge the dominance of the United States, that's still an attractive idea for some people around the world. For governments, of course, the great attraction, particularly with respect to China, is that it comes with money and projects and roads and investment, and it doesn't lecture us, it doesn't condition any of that on stupid things like human rights or environmental protection or labor rights or anything like that. I would encourage you to look at the speech that President Obama gave to the African Union late last year. And this was mostly to officials, and one of his big applause lines was basically, we're not like China. He didn't say China. He said, we're not like some other countries that offer you that deal that I just mentioned. You know, when you deal with us, there's a lot of good that comes with it. We're going to try to fight poverty with you. We're going to try to stand up for development. When we build a road, we hire your workers. We don't bring in our own from overseas. If our companies pay a bribe, we'll prosecute them. And a lot of other things people really like about doing business with the United States and about our model and our values. And part of the bargain is we're going to talk to you about stuff that you don't like to hear. And you know what? That's just who we are. And he said, you're kind of stuck with us. And enormous applause in the audience, people laughing and like, yeah, you know, that's right. So I think, you know, we just have to be honest about it. This is the bargain. We're going to talk to you about boring, tiresome things like political prisoners and not raping your environment and treating your workers better and corruption when it happens. We're not, you know, we're not going to invade you. We're not going to, I mean, there was a time when people could have accused us of that quite legitimately, but certainly not this president. But we're going to talk to you about uncomfortable things. And you get all these benefits. And I think most countries in the world, certainly their citizens, would take that deal over what they're getting from some of the other great powers. With Russia, you get invaded now, as we see in Ukraine. With China, you get a development model that is not necessarily one that a lot of people in developing countries, ordinary people, find particularly attractive when it's exported to their soil, even though what's, you know, economic development in China far away may seem attractive to them, but what they get in terms of the investment may not seem quite as attractive. I'll take one more. That way I can be the good guy and you can be the bad guy.
Okay, this gal in front.
All right. Hi, are you pointing to me?
Yeah.
Saudi Arabia, can you share how your department works with Saudi Arabia, either with the royal family or the El Sidari princes, with human rights issues in that country? Because they seem to be acting a bit totalitarian lately.
Really? just lately. I think, look, it is no secret that we have a complicated relationship with Gulf countries, with Saudi Arabia in particular. And I'm a very big believer in the principle that in the longer term, there are absolutely no trade-offs between promotion of human rights and our national security interests. I believe in that passionately. In the very short term, there are sometimes choices we have to make. We do business with governments that abuse human rights, and we try to be honest about that in the Obama administration. We don't, you know, we don't sugarcoat Saudi Arabia's human rights record to justify working with them on counterterrorism or being partners with them in, you know, the counter-ISIL campaign or trying to get them to donate money to good things around the world that we're trying to do, or talking to them about Israeli-Palestinian peace in those moments when we feel like progress can be made. So you can be honest about the value of doing those things and honest about the really deep and significant human rights problems in Saudi Arabia, and also about the long-term consequences of denial of human rights within a country like Saudi Arabia, particularly, and you mentioned this, to the Shia minority, because that denial of rights feeds into the whole Sunni-Shia divide that is driving so much of what's going wrong in the Middle East today. I think I would be justified in saying by the evidence of what we have been saying and doing that we have, I think, increased our attention in the last couple of years to the human rights piece of that complicated equation. When they executed the Sheikh al-Nimr, we condemned it publicly. We talked to them about it privately beforehand, and then we condemned it publicly after it happened. We have spoken out publicly on many cases in the last year. I mentioned the flogging of the blogger as one case in particular that we have spoken out on, and we are going in talking to them on a regular basis about these cases. And sometimes, usually when we've spoken publicly, it's because something bad has happened. Oftentimes, I think through the very close diplomatic relationship we have, we're able to make progress in individual instances through the private conversations. And then when we do, you never know about it because we don't then trumpet it publicly for obvious reasons. We talk to them very seriously about the conduct of their military campaign in Yemen. It's another complicated issue for us because, you know, we agree that the government of Yemen should not have been violently thrown out of Sana'a and most of the country by the Houthi rebellion. But at the same time, we have both publicly and privately expressed very deep concern about indiscriminate military strikes by the Saudis and other members of the Saudi-led coalition, which are not only wrong, but make matters worse in Yemen and not better. And we've had people, including from my bureau, sitting with Saudi military officers involved in planning and executing that campaign, working through with them how to improve their targeting, how to avoid hitting civilians, and we hope that will have some impact. So it's a complicated relationship. Human rights is part of the equation. I think it's a growing part of the equation.
Yeah, some closing remarks. Any advice for the students in the room that would be interested in having a career like yours, both in the government sector and in non-governmental organizations?
Don't study too hard, because then you'd be focusing on just one thing. Eat healthy food, stay in good shape, travel the world, mm-hmm. be happy. All right, now I'm just rambling. That's all good advice. It's really, really good advice. My folks make fun of me for the green juice that I have for lunch every day. There's no, it's a hard question to answer because there's no single path. I do think if you're interested in human rights, it's really helpful to have some experience overseas. And when you come to Washington and take your rightful place as an assistant secretary of state or a senior director at the National Security Council or an officer in the U.S. military or a member of Congress and so on and so on and so on, you're not the sort of person who talks about what's happening in Egypt or Saudi Arabia or Iran or Burma or China from a theoretical think tank standpoint, but as somebody who has seen the world through the perspective of those people living in that country. Whether it's working for an NGO or as a stringer or a journalist or an academic experience or frankly anything that can have nothing to do even with the issue that we've been talking about, that gives you that perspective and the realism and insight that comes from having that perspective. It's actually shocking to me how many people in decision-making roles in Washington can't really say that they've had that. They've gone on fact-finding trips and they've been to the capital of such and such for 2 days and met with the deputy foreign minister, but they haven't necessarily had that experience. So that would be one piece of advice. And then just like, agree with everything I said in my speech and, carry that flame forward. I can't be everywhere at the same time.
Terrific. Please join me in thanking Assistant Secretary Tom Malinowski.
Thank you.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.